going to start this class off with some kind of origin story. It's always good to sort of begin with a nice background to the field, a nice issue number one. Give you a sense of what comparative politics is and where the discipline has gone over the past 50 to 60 years. So that is really one of the primary reasons why WIARTA is assigned. Now, we talked in the first day of class last week about comparative politics being both a subfield of political science as well as a methodology. What I want to focus on today is the methodology of comparative politics. So even if you're not all that interested, as I said, in studying international governance, it is a useful methodology, it is a useful form of research inquiry to use when studying a number of other aspects, such as political institutions, voting patterns, economics, types of government, what have you. Comparative politics, and more specifically, the comparative method, functions in both quantitative and qualitative discipline. Now, these are terms that you may not have heard so far. Why am I giving all of this up? Because there's this clash, there's this internal battle within the social sciences, but specifically political science, I think more than the others, as to which is the better discipline. Is it quantitative studies, because it's all statistics and regression models and charts and graphs that undergraduate students love because they're like pictures in a reading. I don't have to read this. It's a page that I don't have to worry about. Yay, it's filler material. Or is it qualitative studies, which is all of the stuff that people use to understand why people do the things that they do? Qualitative studies usually involves the other social science disciplines, history, anthropology, sociology, and yes, sometimes if need be, we'll even bring out psychology. So quantitative studies are usually those types of methodologies that reduce what you're observing to some kind of numerical variable, like ones and zeros, that you can use a number of cases across the board to then provide a nice little graph to show your instructor and give the impression that you know how to operate high sophisticated software. Qualitative studies have somewhat of an ambiguous relationship in political science because qualitative people are constantly told by quantitative political scientists, shouldn't you be a historian? Shouldn't you be, doing some anthropological research in Indonesia or whatever it is, okay, you do all of the hard work and we'll just take it and reduce it to quantitative variables. And, the two people kind of make fun of each other constantly back and forth. Now, if I had to choose one way or the other, and some of you have had me before, and I kind of introduced myself as sort of a closet historian, shamelessly masquerading as a political scientist, I fall on the qualitative side. I feel, and again, we're free to agree, disagree, that in order to understand good political science, you got to start with history. Or at the absolute least, you need to sort of have a bit of a background as to the area, the people, or at least why people do the things that they do. Otherwise, you're just simply going to be asking repeatedly, what's the matter with Kansas? Okay? Qualitative people will give you the answer about Kansas. Quantitative studies will just simply say there's no rational reason for why Kansas does what it does. You all know what I'm talking about, right? There was a study done back in 2004, 2005. The title of the study called What's the Matter with Kansas? Which seeks to explain why people in Kansas voted for George W. Bush and not John Kerry, when John Kerry seemed to embody more of the socioeconomic policies that would have benefited the blue-collar voters than George W. Bush. Some people are probably asking the same thing in the previous election. Why do two blue-collar white voters always vote for the party that seems to operate against their interests? And the quantitative people will kind of scratch their heads and say, well, the data's there, but I don't know why. And the quantitative people will. The qualitative people will say, it's the culture, idiot. Okay? So in that regard, comparative politics is really a form of measurement without metrical ordering. And that's probably the most highly sophisticated definition we're going to get with this thing. Comparative politics is a form of measurement without metrical ordering. In other words, we ascribe certain degrees of value and importance of one variable over another based upon extra criteria that we have to explain. So it's not like one variable is mathematically greater or lesser than another, but for the sake of the argument, for the sake of the research, some things just tend to be more important than others. And that's what you have to kind of work with. Right? There's lots of political scientists, there's lots of policymakers, there's lots of analysts that, you know, are yelling and screaming and shouting at the data by saying this doesn't make sense. The qualitative people within comparative politics will say it doesn't matter if you think it doesn't make sense. What matters is that it makes sense to them. And the minute that you go with that as your starting point, the minute the rest of your research will seem a little bit easier to understand. So to go back to that model, what's the matter with Kansas? The qualitativists will look at that and say, there's nothing wrong with Kansas. Kansas people are voting according to their rational belief. And yes, they may support a political party and they may support a candidate that espouses platforms and policies that may run counter to their own economic interests. There's something else that they hold more important. Okay? That's where I think the qualitative aspect of the comparative method comes in. Because it gives one the ability to draw observation, to draw inference from both experience as well as common knowledge to any observation. So there's a lot of stuff that we're going to be looking at this semester where you just kind of take things at face value because that's what the population under study takes. So again, there's a lot of things you just have to take as a given. Religion's important over here. Religion's not important over there. History matters to a certain degree to these people. To those, nationalism has never really entered into the equation. And the minute that you take that into account, the more you'll come to understand the areas that you're doing research in. And that's why there is a certain degree of normativity within comparative politics as well. You know, normative versus empirical. Again, we're operating with theories, not laws. Right? That's the difference between the natural sciences and the social sciences. The natural sciences will come up with laws. 2 + 2 = 4, whether you're in America, whether you're in Uruguay, or whether you're on Rigel 7, right? 2 + 2 = 4. We're talking about the laws of chemistry, the laws of physics. The social science, do social sciences have laws? No. Because, well, what is the difference between a law and a theory? Okay? The natural sciences have laws. The social sciences, for the most part, have theories. What is a theory as opposed to a law?
It's falsifiable.
Okay, so operating a law, proper academic answer. A theory is something that can be falsifiable. What does that mean? It means that this set of criteria is sufficient to take, given the current amount of data and given what we observe. Right? It's very difficult to come up with laws in the social sciences because laws in natural sciences come about through experimentation, which, if you think about it in the social sciences, it's not only impractical to experiment on people, it's also somewhat unethical. Right? I mean, it's just very difficult to do. But more often than that, when we talk about, you know, you just read your general history of any country, any movement, any society, you realize that a good chunk of a people's history, a national history, whatever it is, have a lot of mistakes, oopses, and deus ex machinas. And that's life, right? That is what makes what this country is, okay? But that is where normativity comes in, right? Empirical theories versus normative theories. Empirical theories are, I come up with a theory based upon observable data. I come up with theories based upon what I can present as the best evidence so far, which may very well become falsifiable at some point, in which case the theory is modified. Normativity, on the other hand, is a little bit different. Normativity is not what you see based on observable data, but what you think should be. There's a certain degree of bias that goes into normative theories, and there's a certain degree of subjectivity that goes into it. These are things that social scientists, especially if you go to grad school, are going to tell you avoid at all costs. But having done this year in and year out, and at this stage of the game, having seen where the fate of countries have been going over the past 2-3 years, I think we have to take subjectivity into a little bit more of a serious state here, because a lot of times things happen not because they make sense, but because people's emotions, people's biases get in the way. And so in this case, the value of the comparative method, which is what we will use it in this class, lays itself bare, right? Within the comparative method, specifically using qualitative studies, we can still apply our area of research to 2, 3, 4, 5, at the absolute most 6 case studies. You know, after a while, you just tend to get bogged down in too much data, too much history, and at some point, a language barrier is going to hit. You can still use a number of cases, okay? The thing to also understand, however, is that coming up with grandiose theories about how the world works, or how democracies work, or why certain political movements and parties come to power when they do, oftentimes gets a little messy, the more vague and the more broad you try to get. So the other thing to understand about this class is that while I will do my utmost to push the theoretical aspect of comparative politics, I also have to remind you that not everything, if we're going to be using theories, fits perfectly. Theories will validate, they don't prove. All right, let me repeat that. Theories validate, they don't prove. Laws prove. Theories validate. Doesn't matter where you are, 2 + 2 = 4. The laws of physics are the same. The theory of democracy changes simply by looking at what we see as democracy in Washington and what our neighbors to the north see democracy in Ottawa versus what our cousins across the pond see in London. So theories validate. And universal theories, this is something that political science has been trying desperately to come up with. Okay? Universal theories, while malleable and flexible, can still bring in a divergent set of cases around the world to be measured locally. In other words, give yourself a certain degree of flexibility. Give yourself a little wiggle room in coming up with broad-based theories to understand that democracies do have a few things that overlap. What's probably the most important thing about a democracy? If you don't have this, you're not really a democracy. You got to at least have this. A peaceful transition power, you can have that in authoritarian states. The death of Kim Jong-il for Lil' Kim was a peaceful transition. You certainly have that. Elections. Got to have elections before anything else. All right? It's like, if you don't even have elections, that's like your door fee. If you don't have elections, you can't come drink at the bar. Okay? Everything else, you can certainly, a peaceful transition is always nice. Nothing wrong with that. But bare bones minimum are elections. Okay, so we can find that across the board in almost every democracy. You don't have elections. Now, here's another thing. Are there countries that have elections that are not democratic? Of course. But are there democracies without elections? Okay, so that's where we begin. And you got to at least have elections.